All right. Good morning. If you guys want to gather in here, we're going to get our service started. Oh man. Well, I had a couple of remarks this morning that I wanted to share. Well, welcome this morning to our worship service. A couple of things here I was going to say, and then just pray for us, and then get our worship service started. We are the church first because we're simply the gathered people of God. So we're the church. I know we're at Evergreen Church, but first and foremost, we're the church because we're the people of God. Secondly, we're a church called Evergreen Church. And then we have a membership in Heaven's Church where there is no denomination or division. Amen. Let's practice that now, you know? Let's just all be unified and practice that and worship the Lord together, the Lord Jesus Christ, that is. You know, we also, I think, you know, what comes to mind when I think about people who are gathering in here online or remotely, we're all at different places. I mean, it would be statistically impossible for everybody to be at the same place, right? So we're all different places. And the two, the dipole, if you will, the north and south end of it, the extreme sides of the spectrum would be, you know, coming in your spirit. You may feel this way, or even it may kind of bleed into your emotion, or it may even affect your physical body as well. But you can be over here and you can feel utterly unworthy, okay, to be in a church service, to even wake up, and you know, you can feel utterly unworthy, or you can feel, you know, completely worthy, and because of your faith in Jesus Christ. When you have faith in yourself or mankind, that's where you get into that unworthy part. And it's once you discover the forgiveness of sin, the grace of God, which is the forgiveness of sin, the plan that Jesus came, he lived, he died, he resurrected, and he offers salvation to those who would simply believe in him. It's actually, it seems too good to be true. But it is a remarkable, the best deal you'll ever find. It costs you no money, nothing in and of yourself, but it's a lifetime commitment. Okay, it's a marriage of epic proportion and of touching every aspect of your life. So don't be mistaken. It's not something you can just do once a day or once a week, or, you know, God's calling you to a loving, intimate relationship, and he wants your whole life. And that's the best thing for us, in fact, actually, because to be unified with your Creator, who knows every detail of you. The Bible says he knows every hair on your head. He understands our proclivities. He understands our things that we're good at, and he understands the things we struggle with. The best place to be is with him. And I have discovered God's grace in a big way, and he leads us every day. And that's a blessing right there. And I also want to just remark that, you know, we live in a reality, you know, like on this side of heaven, if you will, on earth here. We live in a reality where the free will of mankind is in effect, okay? And that means good, bad, and ugly, guys and gals. And that is, it's a heavy reality at times. If you spend any amount of time searching about history of anything, I mean, there's scars and marred things that mankind has done or hasn't done, and it sits heavy on me. And the only place I find freedom is in I look forward to heaven with Jesus, and I look forward to what does God call me to on this earth. As Paul said, as long as I'm here, there's a job to do, there's ministry to do, there's something to do in the kingdom, and so you can make a difference. You can try on your own strength again, like I said earlier, but that will lead to despair and disappointment. We are all, I just want to say it over myself, I want to say it over you. You are officially, if you will, released to follow God, right? To free yourself from mankind. In fact, I'm going to lead into a prayer right now, and then Keith will come and lead us in worship. God, I pray over this group right now. I pray over myself. In the name of Jesus, be free right now. Be free. Be free from the good, the bad, and ugly of mankind. Set us free. Lord, connect us to your heart. Connect us to your will. Lord, let us attach to your grace. Let us just leave and behind our own filthy works. Are the best things we have, God, the Bible even says, is filthy rags. We just don't have a leg to stand on. God, but if we're in Christ Jesus, if we've put our faith, trusted that he is who he said he is, and we believe that he can save us by faith, like we sit down and we believe a chair is going to hold us, that kind of faith, then we can experience the forgiveness of sins, eternal life, John 10:10, abundant life. We're not talking about a blessings for ourselves selfishly. We're talking about a blessings for ourselves for your kingdom. Lord, which is the best thing to ever happen to any one of us would be to follow you, Jesus. Set us free this morning. Lord, transport us to a heavenly time. And I pray over each individual here online and in person. Please touch us. You know how we might need to be touched today. And even if we don't, feel maybe a change instantly, what we're fixing to do is going to be an opportunity to worship you, whether we feel like it or not. And we're going to bring that as a sacrifice. We're going to bring that as an expression of how good you are. We're going to encounter emotions across the spectrum, possibly. But Holy Spirit, lead us in a unified fashion through this moment. And prepare us for the preaching of the word that Danielle's going to bring and the ministry of your Holy Spirit. Lord, the altar and prayer ministry that we've prepared. God, please, we're asking for you to manifest and touch us today. We are so grateful for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
With me real quick. Too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails. No, no, it never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Oh, oh, your love never fails. No, it doesn't, Lord. No, it doesn't, Lord. Things work together for my good. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do, Lord. You make all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Yes, Lord. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me, Lord. Because I know that you love me. Oh, oh, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails.
That's right, Lord.
Your love never fails.
Yes, Lord.
Your love never fails. No, it doesn't, Lord. Oh, you make all things work together. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do, sweet Jesus. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. Yes, you do. You make all things work together for my good.
Thank you, Lord. This next song is new to us here, but I'm sure it's familiar to all of you. Called We Believe. And it just came into my spirit last week as Danielle preached about only believe. And that's needs to be a centering thing for us, that we believe. We just continue to believe everything God has said and every promise He's given.
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back again. We believe. Oh, yes, Lord.
This first verse, in this time of desperation.
In this time of desperation. All we know is doubt and fear.
Yes, Lord. There is only one foundation. We believe, yes, Lord, we believe in this broken generation. When all is dark, you help us see. Thank you, Lord. This is only one. There is only one salvation. We believe, oh Lord, we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. Oh, we believe. Oh, we believe in You, Lord. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptation, we believe, yes, Lord, we believe You, Lord. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again, coming back again. Yes, Lord, His bridge. Let the lost be saved and found in the dead raised. The here and now, let love invade. Let the church live out loud. God will say, we believe, we believe. And the gates of hell will not prevail. For the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know Your love will never fail. We believe, we believe. Oh, oh, yes, we believe. God Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. Yes, You are. We believe in God the Father. We believe Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again. Oh, yes, You are. He's coming back. Jesus Christ, We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. Oh, we believe. Oh, we believe. Oh, we believe. Every promise we believe, everything You said You'll do. The same today, yesterday, forever. We believe everything You said. Every promise will come true, Lord. Cause You're the same day, yesterday, and forever. So we trust You, Lord, forever. Encourage us today that even as we talked about last week, some things that we've believed for a long time that we still haven't seen the answer to, just say, we believe You. Oh God, we believe, Lord. Although it tarries, we believe, Lord. Oh God, though it tarries, we believe, Lord. You are faithfulness, God. Oh, You are faithfulness, Lord. Nothing is sure but You, Lord. Nothing is sure but You, God. Oh, nothing is sure but You, Lord. So we believe, oh God, yes, we believe in You, Lord. Though it tarries, we believe. Though it seems so long, we believe. Though it tarries, we believe. Though it seems so long, we believe. Yes, Lord. Cause You are faithful. Yes, God. You are faithful. Always, yes. You are faithful. Always, You are faithful. We can count on You. Thank You, Lord. Once again, we believe. We believe.
We know these countries hardly. Even as we believe God, we believe for these people. And we know never heaven what up.
We're going to know when we get to heaven. I believe God's going to have special rewards handed out to each one of us because we were concerned about the nations of the world. So let's recite our prayer now. Lord, I pray for justice in the world, for the lifting up of the poor out of their misery, for the breaking of the power of tyrannical regimes, for the end of violence, warfare, racial conflict, and strife. Thank You that You are a God of justice. Amen. And our first country this week is Gabon. And, you know, at first glance, it's not on VOM or Open Doors Watch. So we think, oh, they're okay. But Freedom House says they are not free. And of course, we can see the reasons why. But there was another thing I wanted to point out before we go on our prayer points on this particular country. They have, I believe it's this one right here. Yes, their oil reserves have been the main, you know, resource for their government as well as their people. Of course, it doesn't trickle down so well for their people. But the thing that I noticed was estimates put that they're going to expend their oil by 2025. So the question is, what are they going to do then? Because some of their other resources are not there. They haven't built upon other resources. So that is a prayer of concern. So we need to add that as we pray. And so, Father God, we pray right now over this country. Lord, we ask that you would touch them and help them. We know that their resources, according to this information, is going to end by 2025, possibly. But God, we know that if they, as believers, the believers there will start crying out to you, that God, you can show a different way of importing or exporting that will gain prosperity for their people. And God, we also pray for their president. We pray that he will become a follower of Jesus Christ and that he will govern his country well. Lord, we see all of these facts about the country being marred by different things. But Lord, we know that if our leaders will turn to you and look to you, that God, you will be faithful to guide them in their governance. So we pray right now for this president that God, he will look to you, be saved, and that he will have many that's around him in government that will do so as well. We pray for a renewed devotion to Jesus by these Christians and the majority of them being Catholic. We pray, God, that they will come to you in such devotion, renewed strength, renewed freedom. And Lord, we pray for pastors to be refreshed and that they too will be equipped by the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray against the corruption and the crime that has affected so many negatively in this country. We pray against the violence towards women and for those that are suffering with AIDS and HIV. We pray, God, that you would show them great mercy, Lord, and show them the hope that they have through Christ Jesus, not only for spiritual healing, but for their physical healing as well. Thank you, Father, for looking upon them this day. God, we come to you for Gambia. We pray for the spiritual well-being of the President Barrow and that he will govern well. And Lord, I'm assuming that he's probably Muslim with the stats being what they are. So God, I'm praying that Jesus will make himself real to this man and that God, not only he, but those all around him in government. And Lord, those that are in the country, that there will be this great ingathering of Christians, God. We pray for missionaries to continue to evangelize here. Lord, they've been able to be there and be able to operate under some freedom. But God, we just pray that there will be an explosion of freedom for these Christian missionaries and they will evangelize the Muslim population and that, Lord, there will be a great ingathering harvest in this country. We pray for the small contingency of Christ followers to be encouraged and to have boldness and for evangelicals to evangelize, Lord. We pray for the hungry, the hurting, and the disadvantaged. And we pray for deliverance to the women that are suffering under such violence. God, we pray that you would look upon them. Just as we prayed the opening prayer, Lord, we are trusting that you see everything that every person has to undergo, God. And we're just ask now that you would be with these people in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we pray over Georgia. God, we pray for this woman that is the first president, and maybe she's in name only, not so much in governance like the prime minister, but we pray that both of these, the president and the prime minister, will be Jesus followers. God, it's not enough to say we believe as a Christian. We have to walk that faith and that belief out, and we pray this over them. We pray that they will govern their country well. We praise you, God, that there is a booming devotion to the Orthodox Church. Lord, that the church attendance is booming and adherence and respect for the church is growing. So God, we thank you, but let that translate into them being devoted to you, Jesus Christ. We pray that evangelical churches will grow and for the unity between them and the Orthodox Church will just become more and more cemented. We pray that the population will have opportunities for viable employment. God, we ask that you would look upon this state or this country now and that you will do what is good for this place in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we pray for Germany. We pray that this new Chancellor Scholz to be a Christ follower and to govern well. We pray for the Christians to be evangelistic and for churches to be revived by the Holy Spirit. And Lord, they boast that they have the tallest church. Lord, that's great, but we want them to have experience with you. Lord, that this is not just a fact, but that, Lord, there is feet. This 530 feet, that there's going to actually be feet to this, Lord, that they will go out preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is the birthplace of Martin Luther. So, God, they have foundations here. We pray, Lord, that you would touch the Protestants and the Catholics alike, and that, God, this church, this country will become such a renewed place of the gospel. We pray that Germany will be known as a country that offers the bread of life. Lord, they boast that they have 300 different kinds of bread. The main thing that we need to boast of is that we have the bread of life and that we can give it out to whoever wants it, Lord. We pray that now. We pray that the government will use winsome and importing oil because, God, their main supplier is Russia, and we know how that is going right now. So, God, we pray for this country that they'll have wisdom on how to import from other countries, God. Just open doors up for them, we pray, and give them wisdom. And, Lord, now we come to Kansas. Lord, we pray that Governor Laura Kelly will be a follower of Jesus and will govern this state well. Lord, there are concerns about them overriding the conservative voices over male athletes now being able to go right alongside the girls in their athletic endeavor. So God, we pray against that too, Lord. It's just such a culture that has come in that has messed things up and it's made good bad and bad good. So God, we just pray that you would even take care of those that would legislate in this particular state. We pray that Christians will have a renewed devotion to Christ and spreading the gospel. We pray that the historical event in Topeka as home of Pentecostalism will be a present day occurrence, Lord, that it won't be something in the past that they look back to, but it's something they live out on a daily basis. And God, we pray against the rise in drug use and crime. Lord, we don't know what the genesis is of that other than it's the devil wanting to destroy. So we pray, God, that you would just come into these places, Lord, in these churches and these Christian believers and put a new, refreshed boldness in them and a burden, God, to reach those that are in these addictions and even in the crime. We pray for our military personnel that are there, that God, you would bless them and let there be great a contingency of Christian believers on these military bases. And we pray that the agricultural business will thrive as well because, God, they also produce for all of the U.S. We just now bring all of these places to you, knowing that, God, your eyes are everywhere, seeing all things. And we bless these countries in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Okay, we're so thankful everyone's here in person and online, and I want to welcome you to Evergreen. We did have one prayer request come in this weekend, and so I'd like for us to say a quick prayer about that as we're going into our sermon time, our word of the Lord time. So one of our members that attends online, Dee Stewart, which is actually Sui's mom, but her sister-in-law Margie had a really intense surgery, and I believe there was amputation involved. So she's going through therapy to regain her full function, and that's going well, but we've been asked to pray that there will be the cost of having a ramp built onto their home that God will provide. So we want to ask that God will provide that for Margie, and that her therapy will continue to go well. She'll be released from the hospital this week. So if you'll join me in a quick prayer for Margie. Father, we lift up Margie right now, Dee's sister-in-law, and we pray, God, that you would continue to be with her. We want to thank you, God, that you got very important surgery. And Lord, I know that this was a difficult surgery that she had to go through, but Lord, thank you that she is going now through therapy. You have brought her this far, and we believe you'll bring her all the way. Yeah. And so, Father, we pray that you administer Margie physically, spiritually, that you would touch her heart, that you would bring her your peace, the revelation of who you are and the love that you have for her. We also ask that you would make a way for Margie and her family to be able to have this ramp built on to their home, so that she will, her and her husband Irwin will not have such a hard time getting in and out of the home. But God, just please, we are asking for that provision to roll in, and that it will be done at a good cost for this family. And we trust you with this need. And again, we thank you for Margie's recovery. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Thank you for joining me in prayer. And we're going to believe for good news to hear that from Margie. So today, I really feel like God wants to do something freeing today in our service and hearing the word of God. And I'm excited about the people who are streaming in with us. And I even think one of our guests that was here this morning for Bible study with the guys, Abraham, has joined us as well. So just welcome to everybody. But what we're going to be talking about, we're going to be in Romans 7, but we're going to read that. We're going to read about 36 verses in total, but we're going to read it slowly because I want us to understand what Paul is saying. Because if you don't read Romans slowly and carefully, you could walk away from it just being like, whoa, that was a lot of information, but not maybe not all of that stuck in your spirit. So, but the reason I believe this is a very freeing message today is if you are a person that's ever dealt with kind of the same thing over and over and you want to get free of something, this is a message for you. I think most of us could raise our hand and say that there are times in our lives that we just keep doing something that we don't want to do, right? We keep falling into the same traps. But today, I'm telling you, because of what the word of the Lord is going to say, you don't have to do that anymore, okay? You can be free. And the Lord really showed me this in a new way this week. So I wanted to encourage us, but we're going to start, let me get to my verse here. We're going to start in Romans chapter 7, verse 1. So, and really the sermon today is condemnation or grace. So that's what we're talking about, condemnation or grace. So here we go. Let's start reading. Now, dear brothers and sisters, you who are familiar with the law, don't you know that the law applies only when a person is living? And he's obviously talking about the law of Moses here. For example, when a woman marries, the law binds her to her husband as long as he is alive. But if he dies, the laws of marriage no longer apply to her. So while her husband is alive, she would be committing adultery if she married another man. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law and does not commit adultery when she remarries. So I'm going to pause here. So we all understand that Paul's using an analogy, right, to compare the law being upon us versus, and you know, but using a man and woman being married to deliver that. Okay, so in verse 4, so my dear brothers and sisters, this is the point. You died to the power of the law when you died with Christ. And now you are united with the one who was raised from the dead. As a result, we can produce a harvest of good deeds for God. That's really good news right there. When we were controlled by our old nature, sinful desires were at work within us, and the law aroused these evil desires that produced a harvest of sinful deeds, resulting in death. Okay, so Paul just said, now because you're with Christ, you can produce a harvest of good deeds for God. He's saying, but when you were under the power of the law, sinful deeds were, a harvest of sinful deeds were resulting. In verse 6, but now we have been released from the law, for we died to it and are no longer captive to its power. Now we can serve God, not in the old way of obeying the letter of the law, but in the new way of living in the Spirit. Well then, am I suggesting that the law of God is sinful? Of course not. In fact, it was the law that showed me my sin. I would never have known that coveting is wrong if the law had not said, you must not covet. But sin used this command to arouse all kinds of covetous desires within me. If there were no law, sin would not have that power. At one time, I lived without understanding the law. But when I learned the command not to covet, for instance, the power of sin came to life, and I died. So I discovered that the law's commands, which were supposed to bring life, brought spiritual death instead. Sin took advantage of those commands and deceived me. It used the commands to kill me. But still, the law itself is holy, and its commands are holy and right and good. But how can that be? Did the law, which is good, cause my death? Of course not. Sin used what was good to bring about my condemnation to death. So we can see how terrible sin really is. It uses God's good commands for its own evil purposes. I want to pause for a second. If you think about Adam and Eve in the garden, that's the serpent tempting Eve and saying, you know, did God really say don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? That's the same thing that the sin has done with the law in order to deceive us. Does that make sense? So God's command to not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was not, that was holy law. That was his law. The law he gave Moses was holy. It was his law. Don't covet, don't murder, etc. Those are holy things. But there's really a connection here with the Garden of Eden where Satan, sin, those are together. And that's the same thing that's happening all the way forward into Romans, where he's making a case about the law being the thing that is holy, but Satan and sin being the ones that twist that to take advantage of it. Okay, so I just wanted us to kind of think about how that corresponds all the way back to the beginning. So in verse 14, so the trouble is not with the law, for it is spiritual and good. The trouble is with me, for I am all too human, a slave to sin. I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. But if I know that what I am doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law is good. So I'm not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. And I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I am not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. Okay, so real quick, another pause. All of us, we are human. We can all relate to this little passage. How many times have you said, I really wish I hadn't said that. I really wish I hadn't done that, right? Even as a Christian. So some people may say, well, that's pre-Christ. Yes, that's pre-Christ, before you let the power of the Spirit take over. However, I'm sorry to give you the news that as a Christian, you're still going to have to allow the Spirit to touch you, and you're still going to have a conflict with sin the Adamic nature that is at work in this world. That's part of why we groan and desire for Jesus to come back, is to be completely freed from sin, temptation, death. Okay, so what I want to do today is, if somebody doesn't know Jesus, I want them to hear this good news and realize they don't have to stay in sin. But I also want to say, if you do know Jesus and you keep getting caught in the same web, whatever it is, little, big, medium size, whatever thing that you like to give a degree to, you can be free of this. So this is the same thing. So we're going to finish it up now. Let's see, in verse 21, and then we're going to go into Romans 8:1 and read that one verse. But Romans 21, I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Thank God, the answer is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So you see how it is. In my mind, I really want to obey God's law, but because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin. We're going to switch over now, and we're going to read the next page, Romans 8:1. I'm going to read it in NKJV, but I believe we still have it in NLT up there. But this is what it says. So he went from saying, the answer is Jesus Christ. You turn over one verse, and then he says, there is therefore. So because Jesus Christ is the answer, now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. We're going to stop there, and we're going to really push into Romans 8:1 for a little bit. Later, we'll read a few more verses, but really we're going to press into Romans 8:1 because that's really where what it's all about today. You know, he said, there is therefore now no condemnation. So, you know, when you say therefore, you're saying, you know, as a result of, when Paul or any of these writers use therefore, they're really wanting you to understand what they had just talked about. So he's saying, because Jesus Christ is the answer, since Jesus Christ is the answer, now there's no condemnation if you are in Christ Jesus. And then I really love how NKJV, New King James Version, says, talks about for those who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. I want to talk about according to. This is where the key lies. Okay. The key lies in this. According to, by Merriam-Webster, it means in conformity with, as stated or attested by, depending on. So this is what I want us to do. We're going to put that into the verse, and we're going to say, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk in conformity with the flesh. They don't walk what the flesh says. They don't depend on what the flesh does, but they walk in conformity with the Spirit, as stated by the Spirit, as attested by the Spirit of God, as depending on what the Spirit says, agreeing with the Spirit. What are you saying, Spirit of God? Where are we going, Spirit of God? If you let that sink in, we won't make the same decisions that we would make if we were walking according to the So the key is two things: how we walk according to, and then here in a minute, we're going to talk even more about condemnation versus grace. But that according to is how we will stay in the grace of our Lord, stay doing what we want to do, where we will become what we want to become in the Lord. So as we interchange all of these phrases for according to the Spirit, not the flesh, really that verse comes alive and it hits with the full power that it has. Paul set that up for a long time. Even if you look in Romans 5, Romans 6, but in Romans 7, we did that full chapter. And the reason I want us to take our time reading it is because he is describing a real problem. So by the time he gets to Romans 8:1, That is so powerful that he says, but now you don't have to worry about that anymore. Now you're not under this condemnation. Now you're free according to the Spirit of God. That is really good news for everybody. And then now I'm going to very quickly, I'm going to read through Romans 8, 2 through 11. And the reason I'm doing that is just to finish that out so that then I can get back to what the Lord put on my heart to actually explain to us some of these keys. But in Romans 2 through 11, and I am going to continue in NKJV on Romans 8, 2 through 11. So even if it's, he's not going to present it. You can just listen to this. So after he said, there's therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. He then says in verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. You hear it again. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit of God, the things of the Spirit of God. For to be carnally minded, meaning to think on the things of sin, is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity, it's an enemy against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And here's the last verse we're going to read. But the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So he'll give you the life and ability to walk according to the Spirit. He will, and Paul even has even more meaning to it, that in the end of time, when Jesus comes to gather his church back to himself, that resurrection life will also come with you, come in, alive in you, and bring you, as you, the moment Jesus appears, death, life. You're right into life, right? Okay, so I just want us to hear the rest of that, but here are some comments that I feel like, again, will be very much a key to help us. So back in Romans 7, 6, you know, we were talking about what the law cannot do. But I want to say this. Since Christ Jesus fulfilled the law and brought it to completion in perfect obedience in himself, the power of the law is now the righteousness of Christ. So now the power of law has been metamorphosized through Jesus Christ into the righteousness of himself in us. Does that make sense? That's a very powerful thing. Because Jesus fulfilled the law, he was able to digest that into righteousness on the cross and then give the resurrection that to us. So you see how we can never be accused as Christians as a sect of Judaism, because I believe that's what we are. We can never be accused of not fulfilling the law, because we do fulfill the law through Christ Jesus. He actually is that embodiment that lives in us that makes us fulfill the law. So this is why we cannot do it ourselves, right? Because we have to step into Christ's righteousness. We have to get under grace. Otherwise, we're just in the same boat that we already were in pre-Christ, that everybody else is in, waiting for Jesus. Or what condemned Christians that are not victorious, the boat they're in, okay? So this is a very dangerous subject in the sense that Christians can operate under condemnation and still be in Christ. And you're like, what? I'm saying you can still walk around feeling accused and be a Christian. That means you are not living out your real inheritance in Christ. You are not free, okay? And you are setting yourself up for some disaster, but the good news is you don't have to. That's what I really want us to hear today. We don't have to do that. And this is another comment I want to make. So the letter of the law, Paul likes to talk a lot about the letter of the law versus the freedom that's in the spirit. When he's talking about the letter of law, he's not talking about the law, like he said, being unholy. He's defending the law being holy. What he's saying is the letter of the law, where if you don't do everything perfectly in your own human strength, then you are in trouble. That's the letter of the law that he's talking about. So the letter of the law, back when the law was given to Moses and then to Israel, what it wanted to do was, I want us to kind of visualize this. That law exerted external pressure on the person and community, okay? It pushed on you to effect internal change. But this is amazing good news. But the newness of the Spirit of God living in us exerts internal pressure, right? And pushes from the inside out on us and the community, which effects external change. And thereby causes us to continue to fulfill the law just as Christ did for us because of righteousness, okay? Because now righteousness is the force that's inside of us exerting and pushing out of us. Guys, that's like, that is absolutely supernatural miracle. We're talking, that's why you can meet somebody that was a liar, a murderer, a cheat. One day, they meet Jesus, and the next day, they are the most saintly person alive and doing the works of God because they died. Their former life died. Then they came new with Christ. And suddenly that righteousness is exerting so much force on the outside of them that everything changes around them. Amen. That's why Jesus is like, you're the salt. You're the light. He knew when he raised from the dead, when the Spirit of God came, everything was going to change. The fulfillment of everything that the prophets talked about, where they, and when Ezekiel talked about, he'll take out a heart of stone and put in a heart of flesh. Mm-hmm. You know, where we hear that no longer will the law be something external, will become written on your hearts. Mm-hmm. You know, in Deuteronomy, it talks about you won't need somebody to teach you. It'll be near you. It'll be right in your mouth. That's what in Romans 10, Paul talks about. So suddenly we just see the power. This is why Paul, when he's talking about salvation, you will not find him without the words of about the Spirit of God on his lips. Mm-hmm. He'll always say, when you receive the Spirit. Because in his mind, when you receive Jesus, you receive the Spirit of Christ. You receive the tutor. You receive the internal helper and guide that will never make you go wrong. Mm-hmm. When we go wrong, it's because we didn't listen to the paraclete. We kind of pushed him out. We made ourselves dull to him. But if we listen to him, we won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Amen. If we listen to him, we'll walk according to what he's saying to do. Mm-hmm. Our life will have a different trajectory. Mm-hmm. And it won't be us constantly under this horrible, dull, you know, law of sin and death, but it'll be us under this live Spirit of God. And so, anyway, so then, as this righteousness is the force exerting out of us, the law of Moses, the Ten Commandments, treating people right, all of that, that's summed up in the law of love, which is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, your neighbor as yourself, what Jesus said. Suddenly, all that's summed up and it gets done. You're fulfilling it. You are the law of love and righteousness in motion as you're going. So in that way, we continue to fulfill the law. And in Christ, in freedom, because we're not under condemnation. Okay, and this is what I want to say too, is condemnation and grace cannot inhabit the same place. They won't. They can't. They can't. You can't have them together. Just like the Spirit of God will not live in a temple with Satan. Will not do it. And that's what Jesus said. He's like, you know, you'll either serve God or money. Money meaning mammon, meaning the whole world system, everything else that the pagan, the heathen run to. You'll serve one of them.
Right.
So you just, you know, even if we're not trying to serve something bad, if we're not under the lordship of Jesus, we are naturally serving that. That makes some people upset, but it's the truth. Amen. So that can make us upset if you're like, I'm a good person, even though I'm not a Christian. I'm not saying you don't do good things. I'm just saying you haven't come under the lordship of Christ, so you're going to keep doing things you don't want to do. That's all I'm saying. Amen. And then even when we are under the lordship of Christ, we still sometimes do things we don't want to do. And this is the key. Get under grace. Stop giving in to condemnation. So since they can't inhabit the same place, we're going to talk about that. So if we're operating under condemnation, even as a Christian, we open ourselves to the controlling power of sin and death. Okay, we really do. Even if you're a Christian, if you say, no, I'm not going to accept that forgiveness from Jesus because I keep messing up in that area, then you are going to keep messing up in that area. Okay, and that's bad news. That's bad news. You may wonder, where did she get these messages? Well, this one came right through my own life. So I felt like a week or and a half ago or two that something was trying to crop back up. And I was like, man, I told Sue, I was like, I think it's back. So I'm not free. What are we going to do? Stewie walked up to me, laid his hands on me in faith and said, no, that's not true. He started praying. And I accepted that that was a false narrative. And I said, thank you for your forgiveness, Jesus. And it came off of me.
Yes.
It came off, right. And 2 seconds later, I went to do what your condemnation human side does, where you're like, well, Lord, I really want you to forgive me of that. And then the Holy Spirit was like, I already forgave you. I don't really know what you're talking about. If you're going to ask it again, you didn't believe me. If you're going to ask it again, you didn't accept it. And I was like, I totally believe that you forgave me. And I can't explain the lightness and the freedom that that caused. I wanted to dance. You know, that's what it's like to be a Christian. That's our normal Christian life, is we are in freedom, excuse me, from sin and death. And so, sorry, people in person heard that more than online. Okay, let me get a drink. Maybe that will help. Give me a second. Okay, so even as Christians, we open ourselves up to sin and death when we let condemnation control. But if you're under the grace of God, you open yourself up to be controlled by the Spirit of God, which means you accepted that forgiveness. What I just told you, my own testimony. Amen. That means you accepted the forgiveness of Jesus. Amen. If you got under his grace, right? Amen. So I want to say this. Being under the Spirit of God and grace will result in three things. Joy. You'll have more joy. You'll have freedom. And you'll have lightness. You will not have baggage that you're pulling around everywhere you go. Because the thing is, if something comes back up 2 seconds later or a day later that you were struggling with, if you're under grace, if it tries to come back up, you are now more in the driver's seat to say no to it, right? But another thing is, if you do mess up again, you more readily receive the forgiveness of God and you move on. When you are under condemnation, it will feel like, and it will be heaviness, restriction, sadness, and dullness. There will be a dullness to your spiritual life. Nobody's going to want to come to Christ around that. They're not. Because that's what the world thinks we are as Christians. If you look at media like on shows and things like that, first of all, they don't really know what it's like to live in Christ, or they wouldn't portray it that way, just for the record. But they don't know. So that's okay. It's ignorance, but we're going to let them do it anyways. Persecuted for Christ's sake, right? Even in the media. So, but when they portray Christians as very dull, having no life to them, having no hobbies, no three-dimensional virtue. They see us as a flat, one-dimensional piece of paper. That's not the truth, actually. We're completely risen with Christ. We're full, fully dimensional people that have life to give others. But the thing is, if we walk around with condemnation, if we walk around heavy and dull and with baggage, we're feeding into the exact narrative that they see. You know, that whole self-flagellating where you're like taking a whip and beating yourself to make yourself be punished. Jesus already took it. He already took the pain. He already took the whipping for everything that we would ever need. And he did it because he's the only one who could do it. He did it because he's faithful, because he loves us, and because he is the Lamb of God who was slain before the foundations of the earth. So what I want to say is, if we will live in freedom and the liberty that Christ has called us to, then people will be attracted to that. And we'll just be operating out of everything that Jesus has called us to. It's a wonderful feeling. So what the enemy does, like Paul was saying in Romans 7, through sin, he takes advantage of the law. And so even with Christians, if you have condemned yourself for something and you're going through your own human mode of trying to make up for what you did and asking God for forgiveness a million times but not accepting it, you know what you're doing is you're perpetuating the fact that you're about to do it again. Because even though we read the word and it's on paper, it's not just on paper, it's living and active. So anything that's being talked about here in the Word of God is a spiritual reality that we're living out one way or the other.
That's right.
So if you are operating under sin and death through condemnation, you are actually under a spiritual living principle that you can't get out of until you get under grace.
Amen.
So it's actually lording over you,
right,
which is such a horrible thing because you already belong to Christ.
Amen.
And you're free. You don't have to be under that. You just step into the grace and say, I receive your forgiveness. And I thank you that I can't do it, but you did it. And I'm
Amen.
Forgiven now.
Yes.
And so that's the key.
Yes.
Is the key is when I'm faced with condemnation, when I'm faced with grace, I'm going to choose grace.
Amen.
And the thing is, if you can't get to grace on your own, ask someone to pray for you. If you can't get there on your own, ask someone to help you. That's okay.
Yeah.
If I model anything, being here, you know, giving the word to you, I pray that I model being vulnerable and going for prayer and saying it's okay to ask for help and it's okay to ask for prayer.
Amen.
Because that's why we have the community of faith, is so that we're with each other, helping each other. So I want to say this too. When Paul is talking in Romans, he's talking to Jewish and Gentile believers in Messiah. And so he's harmonizing them all together because he doesn't want people throwing. I want y'all to know the historical context. So he's not wanting to throw the law out. He's wanting to show how the law is holy so that Gentiles don't think, oh, well, the law doesn't matter,
right,
you know. But he's also wanting the Jewish messianic believers to know you're free. Like, you are free completely in Jesus. So he's really harmonizing these churches that are at Rome. But this is what I want to say. When God spoke to Abraham in, you know, all the way back in Genesis, what he was saying to Abraham when he made covenant with Abraham is, you are blessed because you believe. That's it. You're blessed because you believe. Later, when God gave Moses the law to give to the people, and the reason I say it that way is I want us to understand there had to be a mediator with the law, because Paul talks about that. So when God gave Moses the law and then gave it to the people, what it said is, you are blessed if you obey. It became conditional. So you say, well, believing is conditional. Yeah, but Abraham believed and it was accounted as righteousness. Under the law of Moses, you had to obey and then your sins were pushed forward. That's very different. And so Jesus came in and did what the law, we couldn't do. He did it. And so in that way, he fulfilled not only the law of Moses, but he also continued the Abrahamic covenant, the promise of if we believe, we will receive faith, receive Jesus. And so today, I pray that this message will set others free. This has really helped me, this message. And I, you know, everyone experiences the Lord in different ways, but when I received kind of that new moment of freedom when Stewie prayed for me, I mean, he went on about his day, and then I went upstairs, and it was just the Lord said, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So, you know, if we will even memorize that verse, and it says, who do not walk according to the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit, if we will even memorize that verse and really let it get down into us internally, we will know that all of our righteousness is Jesus. We will know that only by grace are we going to survive. And not just survive, but thrive. That's the thing. The grace of God will cause you to thrive the condemnation will cause you to feel like you're just barely surviving. You're barely getting by. And that's not of the Lord. So Jesus didn't raise for our semi-victory or our barely getting by. He raised for our total victory. And so that's why we accept his forgiveness. And the more we're under grace, the more authentic we will be to people around us. They'll be like, oh, so even if that person that's a Christian that follows Christ makes a mistake, they don't stay there. They keep walking with the Lord and they're joyful in the next breath and they're fine, you know? But the component that I meant to say was dangerous earlier is if we stay under condemnation, what ends up happening is what had could have been an issue that would have been resolved with grace can become a besetting sin that we almost can't get out of, where we're around the mountain and it's like we can't figure out how to get out, how to get home. Okay. So that's what I mean. It's very imperative that we understand that we need to come under grace and stay under grace and not let that condemnation point its finger at us, because it is of the devil. But I want to read a quote to you. Let's see, let me find it. And this was from a YouVersion devotional, and it was on the Minor Prophets. And it says, and it was called Hidden Prophets, but this is what the quote says. It says, we are justified in doubting our relationship with God only if we could imagine God being dissatisfied with the life and sacrifice of Jesus Christ, our representative. That's powerful. I'm going to read it again, so it'll kind of like sink in some more. So again, this is helping us with grace to receive it. We are justified in doubting our relationship with God only if we could imagine God being dissatisfied with the life and sacrifice of Jesus Christ, our representative. Again, that's from Hidden Prophets on YouVersion Devotional. So with that being said, you know, I'm not standing up here preaching that it never matters what you do and it's okay to act however you want. I'm not doing greasy grace where it's just like anything goes. I'm talking about grace, the grace of our Lord Jesus. That is the power that pulls us home, that shows us the way. The Holy Spirit comes to us by grace, points to us, points the cross to us, points Jesus to us. We come alive in Christ, and then grace is actually what continues to go with us all throughout our faith journey, all the way home. Home to Christ, you know, home to Christ by the grave, or home to Christ by his return, but home. And so what I want to encourage you to do, because this is something that growing up in the faith tradition that I was from, we didn't talk about praying for grace in a certain way. So my parents were good at explaining grace to me to help me, like from a home, like a home education understanding with the Bible and being a Christian. But we didn't pray for grace the way that I've heard some other faith traditions kind of really lay hold of it as a thing to wrap your arms around. So that's what I want to say, is when you and I are having a hard time, I want you to stop and ask for grace. I want you to say, God, I need your grace right now. You know, if you need forgiveness, ask for forgiveness. But right after you ask for forgiveness, ask the Lord to fill your life with grace, that thing that was really bothering you, give it to him and say, God, I need your grace, because I don't know. I don't handle this thing that keeps coming up. I don't know. You know, you forgave me of the thing I did wrong, that you showed me I did wrong, but I don't know how to handle this issue. It keeps coming up. If you'll ask him to fill you with grace, he'll show you what to do in that moment. And in fact, what he does often is he'll just take over and do it for you. That's what's amazing. He'll take things out of your hands and fix things for you. So he doesn't always do that way, but I'm telling you, if you will begin to pray for grace, he will do things like that for you more and more, because he knows that there are things that we can't do. Just like last week when we talked about only believe, there's things that's out of our human grasp. He knows that, even for the daily things that we need help from. But I pray that this message today has really given you a key to freedom. That's what the heart of this is, and what I feel like the Lord was showing me is this is a key to freedom. And as believers, if we'll access that key and use it, we won't keep going around the same mountains. We'll stay free of those things. And so I want to say a prayer over us for grace to come in our lives more. But then we may have some more prayer after that. But let's just go to prayer together. Heavenly Father, thank you that your grace is powerful and abundant, and it's manifold to us, meaning it is just in constant waves coming to us over and over and over. And Lord, I pray that we would all hear as evergreen. And when I say here, I mean all of us online or in person, just that as evergreen, we will access your grace. Because Lord, I know that there's power in it, because as we do that, we will live in the Spirit. We will actually walk according to what your Holy Spirit is saying, what your Holy Spirit is leading, what your Holy Spirit wants from us, and what the Holy Spirit knows we need. And so, Father, I pray that you would completely set us free from condemnation. I pray, God, that there would not be even a tiny speck of condemnation on anyone that's listening to this message. I pray that no one would feel judged, no one would feel condemned, that would pull off of their lives, out of their lives, and then instead that in that place, the grace will begin to fill. Like if somebody's pouring water in a bucket, I just pray that that water of grace will continue to fill until it's completely overflowing the sides, where it's spilling out everywhere, God, onto even the people around us, Lord. I pray for that level of freedom, that level of joy, just that excitement to look in the mirror and say, I'm a child of God, and I'm free, and there's nothing that's holding me, and I'm free to do this wonderful harvest of good deeds for God. So, Lord, I just pray that this message will do much more than what words can do, but it will do something by the power of your Spirit, that it will stir in hearts and cause a dynamic change to happen for people, and that they'll be encouraged and strengthened and able, Lord, to be more wholly yours. When I say holy, I mean entire, fully yours, God. And Lord, I just pray that anyone who has felt dragged down or made dull or heavy by condemnation today would be free. Specific people, God, if anybody's felt that, Lord, that it will just be an awakening come right off of them. And for the specific thing that they've been beating themselves up over, I just pray today it would go away and that they would feel brand new. Just like I did when I felt brand new, when somebody prayed for me, I felt brand new. And I just pray that for your people, God. And Lord, anyone who even needs to understand this concept more, Lord, let them read your word, read in Romans 8 again, and just really internalize the scripture until it's everything that's coming out of their lives. And so I thank you for every person here. And Lord, we dedicate this day to you, this service to you. We pray that you'll be glorified even throughout the rest of our week as well. And we thank you that there is therefore now, because of Jesus, no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And if anyone online or in person wants individual prayer, we're here for that as well. Just either chat online or come up here and we'll pray together. So we're so grateful for everyone. We hope you have a wonderful week, and we're looking forward to seeing you next time. Bye-bye. Good. If anybody has any prayer needs, they want to pray together, we can, and we'll have music on so you won't feel like going to mute. You won't feel like you're...
separate. Even if I ran away, your love never failed. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercy for me every day. Your love never fails. Singer, you stay.
You make all things. In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. Do you believe? So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death.
know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercy for me every day. Your love never fails. Singer, you stay.
You make all things work together for my good.